did it again.
It's because of Louis, you know?
Let's keep it. Let's keep it. To those of you listening, we did this intro 12 times, and we said no Italian.
Now it's going to serve as a reminder that we shouldn't go too crazy.
I'll make it go away. I'm going to pour some concrete. You can have a big patio. Yeah.
Dennis watched Goodfellas again.
He's going to be talking like this for a week now. So,
hey, all you are is a floating head right now.
Hey, yeah, I am a floating head. You know what happened? I did a little something. You know, when I get a floating head, that's what happens.
Where's your body, man? My guy? So I want to be honest with everybody right now. For this podcast, we're completely unprepared, but this is the real us. We want to just talk and record this conversation and see where it goes. I'm listening to my voice, me talking.
Right now, one of the biggest things is that we didn't actually see WrestleMania today. And we were hoping to kind of cover that. I mean, we should at least watch it.
Yeah. Right? Hey, we'll do a live reaction of us watching WrestleMania. Dennis, you're the guy that gets the information. You're the facts guy. Please tell me you watched WrestleMania and you have a review.
I watched WrestleMania number 3, and I could give a review on that.
No, I'm talking about the WrestleMania going on right now.
Irrelevant, my friend.
I freaking suck because I just got from the lake after riding my jet ski, and no, I did not ride or watch WrestleMania, whatever number it is.
Roman. Oh yeah, same thing. We couldn't watch it either because we were.
I had to go for a
yacht. No, we were on our yacht because we got his jet ski. We were on our sick yacht,
or we're just being one uppers.
Okay. Nah, I don't have a yacht. And Dennis doesn't have a jet ski.
We're doing whatever you're doing, but just in a cooler way, you know.
I have a wave runner.
Yeah,
he does. Marshall, you couldn't do anything anyway, boy, because you all injured up. What is going on with your injury, Marshall?
Yeah, so I did hurt my knee. I got the doctor said it wasn't a tear or anything, but
it was partially torn, I think.
Yeah, maybe partially torn. But the thing is, I really, really don't want to miss this match with Tom. So I finally get my hands on him. And, you know, I know he's probably going to attack this knee. And so I'm just trying to be prepared. I'm trying not to sell it too much. But right now I still am on crutches. Crutch.
Oh, yeah. Hey, look, for those of you that are tuning in via YouTube, there are, and I'll explain it if you're not on YouTube, if you're like on Spotify. There is a crutch. Okay, now a crutch is something you put under your arm when your limbs are hurt or broken or anything. Anyway, there is a crutch right behind Marshall. It's between Marshall and Ross, and that is Marshall's crutch. He's not using Ross as a crutch tonight, but he is using a crutch.
Oh, like I don't use Ross as a crutch in my matches. Is that what you're saying? That was a jab.
Yeah, that's been a rumor going around for a long time.
Now
let's address it now.
It is a rumor.
Always come in and take all the glory.
No, I don't know, man.
A lot of times I'm getting beat up and I wear them down for you.
When I hear that crowd chanting your name, it just gets me going.
Hey, you know,
get out there, show them what's up.
Hey, what if one time maybe let me push, slingshot me in for a win? You know what I'm saying?
I see what you're saying. Yeah. I see what you're saying. But then, how would I get the win? You know?
No, I know what you're saying. That's true.
Yeah. It's all good.
I'll just bear it down
and never bring it up again.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Let's get on with the show.
Yeah. Never. So we had Chavo on last week, and one of the things we talked to him about was home construction remodeling. How's your remodeling project going, Marshall? Because every time I call you, you're like, I'm hanging.
Dennis, I think that's extremely personal, and I wish you wouldn't have gone there, but now I'm gonna have to go there. Man, I'm
inappropriate,
extremely triggered and offended, but. Yeah, it's going pretty well. Actually a cool story is I framed in for my son's room and it came out pretty big. The room did. Cause right now we have no room. I'm in a 500 square foot house and there's not very much room, but I kind of like that because, we're traveling a lot. So it's easy to get in and out of. It's easy to clean up. But now that I have a kid, it's full of baby stuff. At nighttime, I'm kicking everything and flipping and tripping.
Yeah. You need more room. That's for sure.
My house used to be the hangout. And now they got the baby. You're also going to hang out outside. But
yeah, I'd rather not even go over there now.
I feel it. There's a lot of tension in there. Yeah. Ross and Solomon
just cluttered. I mean,
yeah.
Baby Ross, stuff. And
wait, I'll catch Ross in the room pinching Solomon when they're alone together. It's kind of frustrating, but. So I built this big room and it was too big. It was not too big, but yeah, it was a huge bedroom. And I was like, I said a little prayer and I was like, maybe should I make two rooms? I know it's a simple question, but that way, you know, if like I'm praying all day, might as well ask the big man. And so I just like, okay, I'm going to make two rooms, because I had enough boards. I had exactly enough 2x4s to do the room, like to the last board. I made the second room, and the next day I found out Coral was pregnant. It was pretty crazy.
Oh, wow. That's pretty crazy. Dang.
Yeah. It was pretty nuts.
You never told me that. It's pretty.
Yeah. So what's maybe the Marshall, what's the update there? Do we know if it's a boy or a girl yet? When are we going to know? How are we?
Don't know yet. Don't know. We're waiting. I think we got like, it's like at 16 weeks, we're like 11 or 12.
It's a waiting game right now.
It's a waiting game. But we can, there's this blood test called, what's the name of it? Something. But yeah, it's a blood test you can do, and it'll tell you if the baby, it'll tell you the baby's gender at 10 weeks. But it's also,
she does a blood test.
Yeah, she does a blood test.
Wow, that's crazy.
But also, it's kind of, if the test is for autism, it tests for autism. But with the kind of test that is, it can also
determine the sex.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing the technology. I have another baby related question. Who changes more diapers? You changing Solomon, Coral changing Solomon, or Coral changing your diapers?
All right, so this is a tricky one. Believe it or not,
it's another low blow.
No.
Too close to this. Okay.
But believe it or not, though, Ross actually changed. It was a crucial moment, and I was like, dude, will you please change Solomon's diaper? And he was like, yeah, no problem. And I thought he was like bluffing, but it was actually better than any diaper I've ever changed. It was like perfectly, like, you know, when you put a diaper on fast, it's like sideways, up and down. But this guy's really good at it.
I don't know. It's a gift. What can I say?
Yeah.
For all you people out there with young kids, Ross is now going to give diaper changing tips.
I love it. I don't like the way that sounded, guys. But that's the only thing he offers.
Let's change your kid's diaper. No, I'm just kidding.
But it does make sense because
he made that up. If we're being honest, I still to this day have never ever changed a diaper.
What?
Well, not a number two diaper.
Yeah. He changed a pee diaper. He didn't change a poop diaper.
Yet. Yeah.
For those of you that don't know what the difference is between number one and number two.
Go, why don't you explain?
I'll elaborate. Okay. Number one is just pee. And number two.
That is it?
It's poop. Yeah, it's poop.
Okay.
It's
poop. But I've seen Ross tape his fingers before, so he's good at taping things. So I would think he'd be good at taping up the diaper, Ross, because you.
Yeah. He taped it up like for a match. Taped his knees, his wrists.
Yeah.
Hey, by the way.
Coral changes more diapers, to be honest. She changes more diapers, but I change them if I have to. But I just got a weak. That sounds really sissy of me, but I got a weak stomach. And so if they're like gnarly diapers, I start gagging and stuff, but I still change it.
It's your son, man. It's like a beautiful thing.
It's like my poop, appreciate. Much, yeah. We got the same germ, so figured that's like changing my diaper, which I'd still be grossed out by.
Oh, boy. I feel sorry for the person that's got to follow you.
This is a great subject.
We need to change subjects.
Yeah.
So to those of you wondering, we did not have a guest today. We just wanted to talk and do a little last podcast recap. We thought with Chavo, Dennis and I were talking on the phone, and we're thinking with these conversations we're having with everybody, we could go, you know, 2 hours, hour and a half. So we're thinking about doing part twos with some guests. And then next week, we are going to have a guest. We might have my dad jump in, depending on if he's available or not, but a really good friend of ours in Israel, his name is Addy. He's just a great guy. He's actually the big reason why we signed with MLW. He's, he's like a brother to us.
We met him a long time ago when we did, I think the Impact Show, it was.
Yeah.
And he was just a journalist there, and we just hit it off and just had a good relationship right from the beginning.
Yeah. There's some guys you just click with Addy too. So we were thinking about having him on the show because, you know, he's a lot of people don't know, some do, about the Von Erich name in Israel, but it's my dad said it was the only time that he became like weak in his knees from the sea of people. They found out David Manning was sending the show over to Israel. And at the time it was on the Jordan channel, and Israel only got one channel. They can only have one channel. And so it was World Class Championship Wrestling. And it would come on once a week, right after Shabbat was over. They said as soon as the star would was in the sky, Shabbat was over or whatever, as soon as they could see a star. And he said, so everybody, it was like part of Shabbat to turn on the TV right after it was over to celebrate. And it was world-class championship wrestling. And so that was going on for, you know, 2 or 3 years. And then my dad was getting so many letters from Israel. And he said that him and my mom were talking about this, and they were like, we're getting letters from Israel, like the Bible Israel, because no one's ever like heard of Israel, not heard of Israel, but it was really small back then. They're a young country. They're only 70.
Less than
72 years old. I don't know exactly how old, but they're a newer country. And so my dad went with, I believe my uncle, he went by himself for the first time to do a show down there with a few other guys. And he said that when he was in the plane, guards got on immediately. And they said, make sure you don't make eye contact with anybody. Keep your head down. And my dad looked out the window and there was barricades. And there was just a sea of people. He said the most people he's ever seen at one time in his life. And he's like, who's this for? He didn't know who it was for. And he started walking and he looked at this lady holding a baby and he just like waved and smiled. And he said, the ground started shaking. The barrier started moving. He said it was just like a roar. And he thought he was in trouble because the cops picked him up. The guards did and ran him to a police station. He thought he was getting arrested, but he said it was like got so chaotic and at one time. And so then he said he got there at the guard and talking to the guards and they just watched wrestling videos, but he just couldn't believe how big the name was over there. And so when we got to Israel for my dad's retirement match in 2017, it was just the most like interesting thing to be so far away from home, but feel so at home because like everyone knew who he was.
It like impacted that generation. It was almost like a part of their culture. And it's like, they would have pretend to be wrestling at school and stuff and be Von Erichs and stuff.
There's a saying in Israel, you know, like we have you think you're Superman? If a guy's trying to like pick something up way too heavy for him or something, they say, what, you think you're strong like Kevin Von Erich? Like for some reason, my dad was their favorite. Like my Uncle Kerry was liked, I heard he was liked a lot by more so like the Arabs and stuff, because I think he wore the I don't know. I have no idea why, but he said that he was more liked over there. But the Israel loved all of Von Erichs, but we saw the impact that it had. That's the reason Israel so like close to our hearts is when we went, we saw in the crowd, there's Jews, Arabs, Muslims, every kind of person you could think of. And they're all cheering and booing together. They have their arms around each other. I saw a rabbi and a Muslim with their arms around each other, cheering and stuff. And I was like, of all things, wrestling. It was like unbelievable. And so I definitely think we have like a mission in Israel, and it's we want to keep pursuing Israel. And it's just been the people are so good and the crowd is so hot. One day we hope that Israel is like a wrestling hotspot. And our friend Addy, the guy we're gonna have on next week, we talk about this all the time. And he's just got such a great mind for the business. And
he can give like a firsthand perspective
from what it was like to be a kid in the 80s. His mom and dad have stories of the Von Erichs and what they were doing on that day. And so it's going to be cool to hear, you know, a legit Israeli guy, you know, to hear his perspective. But yeah, he's an awesome brother of ours. Now we've grown like a good friendship.
Yeah. We're looking forward to having him on. I'm looking forward to meeting Addy. And you know, there's so many stories around WCCW in Israel. You know, you hear David Manning talk about the Chris Adams story where Chris kicked somebody in the car in Israel and then had to leave the country. And then, you know,
did he tell that story on the podcast?
No, he told that story on one of the dark side of the ring interviews. Yeah. I believe. And that's amazing. And then your dad's got one on the, where they actually had a temporary ceasefire during a big match back in the day.
That was unbelievable. Is the first time in like years that they had a ceasefire just to watch a wrestling
show. Like it was just, you think of it, it's a fact. Like, I mean, that the time comes on and you're used to watching it all the time. You're like, man, there's this outside conflict. So it kind of transcended wrestling in a way. That was a really cool story in my opinion.
And when we talk to some of the Jewish people, and just not it's not just Jewish people, it's like everyone in Israel, and Israel's so diverse. And it's just like when you ask, because we wanted to know, like, why did they love dad so much? And it makes you feel less crazy because we love our dad a lot, you know. And it was it's unbelievable. The story, like one of them explained it pretty well. A lot of them don't know why they love him so much, but one of them said, you know, like Israel, because my dad said he based his fighting style off of the country Israel. They're small, they're surrounded by enemies. And, you know, my dad thought, you know, he's not the biggest guy. He's a great physique, but he's not the biggest guy ever. But he said that, you know, he wanted to have that kind of heart when he fights, you know, to you know, because Israel, the smallest country surrounded by enemies, never lost a war. They're like number one in like.
Never started.
Yeah. Never start anything. They're like number one in everything, like research. Their military's nuts. You know, they're all their everyone has to join the military, I guess, when you're 18 or whatever. But it's not like it's not as bad as it sounds when you're over there. It's like they do it with honor, and you know, they can still go home and see their family. And it's so cool. We celebrated Hanukkah with a family when we were down there, just us two. And they all told their war stories about the six-day or seven-day war.
Yeah.
But it was just unbelievable. It was unbelievable. And the mother of the guy's house we were at, they're like, she's the most badass one out of all of us.
She's like taking something out of the oven, and she walks like, in and tells a story about, you know,
but she never gave up any. To this day, her job was like if she ever got captured, to not say any information that she has. And so they said I still don't know what she's capable of, but one of the grandpas saw her like do something nuts, like save a hostage, like
strangle a guy or something.
I don't know. Like, it's like crazy, but she wouldn't talk about it. And I was like, man, if that happened to me, everybody would know about it.
I'd lead with that probably.
Hi, I'm Marshall. I strangled a dude one time and saved a hostage. Nice to meet you.
Well, you guys went there though for the retirement match. Was that your first trip to Israel or your second trip? It was your second.
That was our first one, and our whole entire family went. Yeah,
the whole family went. And then you guys did a lot of promotions. You went to schools. Your dad did some commercials. They're out there on YouTube, the commercials your dad did.
Yeah. It was such a great growing experience. For the first time, I didn't dread media. You know, for the first time in our career, not the first time, but the majority of our careers, you know this, Dennis, but we would get so nervous before radio shows, promos, and because in Japan, it wasn't our strong point. Everybody's afraid to expose a weakness. And, you know, that's one thing, you know, God has used Israel or used wrestling in our lives big time. Cause it's, you know, getting uncomfortable. You feel like you're exposing a weakness, but you're really, you know, just giving it to God. I'm going to go out here. I'm going to play the part. I'm going to be a wrestler. I'm going to try as hard as I can, you know, cause you know, we're both pretty shy people, you know, in school, we were both like shy kids. We weren't loud and
introverted.
Yeah. And it's just crazy. We're in a job where you can't be like that. You have to be animated and, you know, and show your emotions and be exaggerated version of yourself. And it's, you know, it's definitely a growing process.
Yeah.
What's funny?
Go ahead, Dennis.
Sorry. No, go ahead, Russ. Go ahead.
No. You go ahead.
You go ahead, Dennis.
Oh, okay. Well, when you guys were doing the independent circuits and you guys stayed with me, I'd always say, well, let's go do an interview for the fans. Let's go do
that's something. What I was going to say. You guys shut it down. So that's what I was going to say. So we were all nervous. Dennis knows this. Dennis would encourage us and tell us, hey guys, you're capable of it. You can do it. You're made for that. You just constantly encourage us and you put us in high pressure. At the time for us, it was high pressure, but that's like one of your gifts is doing radio and all that. You have a great radio voice. And so you being the guy to encourage us and keep us booked helped so much because, you know, after our agent or whatever passed, we shouldn't really our agent, but she helped us get matches and stuff. But yeah, she passed away and we didn't know what we were going to do in the States. We were done in Japan. We knew for a while because our boss just passed away in Japan. And so it's just kind of trippy. Like maybe we shouldn't be wrestling. Everyone's like dying. I felt like that. And then you came in and we met you and you're going through a time in your life where, you know, where we really needed each other and built a great brotherhood from that. But yeah, it was you telling us or seeing stuff in us that we didn't see in ourselves. And yeah, I got so nervous for radio shows, nervous before promos, all this.
Yeah. You believed in us like in a way you're like, I don't know what, but you guys are just going to be successful. You know, I know, and eventually you're going to, you know.
Yeah.
And it wasn't immediate, you know, and we were the last ones to believe that, you know.
And when we saw things coming together slowly, and it was just like, man, it's happening, you know, and it's just every story has that. You got to start off the beginning of something's never beautiful. You know, if you want it to.
The glory is in the struggle.
The glory is in the struggle. My dad always says that it's not about the destination. It's about the journey. And that's so true. You know, he said about, you know, you wake up and your wife's making eggs or your kids are laughing in the living room. It's those little things that you can, like my house right now, I'm so focused on the house and I got to get this stuff done. That, you know, I caught myself missing days. I have time off right now. My wife wants to go to the beach and go to the bike path, me and my brother. And it's now I gotta, you know, do this wall. You know, it's worth it to live in the moment and experience it. Cause you know, you're look back in pictures and like, man, why am I not smiling there? You know, I was like, no, you were concerned about a temporary problem. You and I were talking about this today, Dennis, you know, cause
don't sweat the small
stuff. Yeah, don't sweat the small.
It's all small.
Don't make permanent decisions based on temporary problems. But I wanted to rewind just a second. You know, somebody asked a question this week, and I believe it was Trisha, and I appreciate her asking the question. She said, how did I meet you guys? And you touched on this earlier. You know, I had met you guys, and then a couple months later, I went through a divorce. It was kind of unexpected, but things happened quickly. And you guys were there to support me. Well, a couple years prior, I had met Kevin on Twitter back when he was, you know, had Twitter, was active. And everybody was asking him wrestling questions, rightfully so. And I'd asked him a question about the surf in Kauai, because I'm a wake surfer and I love the ocean.
Yeah.
And your dad had just answered some questions on what the surf was like. And then I got the ding on Twitter that said he started following me. Which, oh my gosh, I can direct message him. So we just started direct messaging and we just kind of go back and forth on things about life. It really didn't talk about wrestling. And I'd share with Kevin that Kauai is one of my favorite places I've traveled to in the world. I've been there two times, once as a kid, second time a few years back, and that I was planning a trip out there maybe in the next year. And your dad said, well, if you come out, come stop by and say hi. Well, fast forward a year and a half later, I actually made that trip out there. And that's where I met you guys in person. The very first time I met you guys was at a place called Sushi Bushido in downtown Kapa'a, the town close to you guys. And remember, I met Ross first. Ross had pulled up on the scooter he was driving. And of course, I knew I'd recognized Ross, introduced myself. Just such a nice guy. And then Marshall, I met you. And then we all had dinner that night with your mom. The whole family came out. And I had my family there at the time. We had the best time. And I remember saw you guys a couple other times during that trip. We went out to dinner the last night we were there in Kauai. And Marshall, you and I and Coral stood out there and talked for about 45 minutes or an hour, just talking, you know, getting to know each other. And I was like, man, these guys are so special. I knew it, but meeting them and being around them. Well, then that was in the fall, early fall. And then I went through, you know, it was a really quick divorce and it really hit me like a freight train. And you guys invited me to come out over Christmas time. So I came out and it was just such a refresh and just a great thing to spend that time with you guys and get to know you. And, you know, and then we just started working together. I wasn't, you know, I was just a wrestling fan from back in the day. I didn't know anything really about the wrestling business, but I knew some stuff about business because that's my background. And we just formed a great team. I put my business knowledge together, your wrestling knowledge. And I remember us saying, hey, we're going to make a lot of mistakes, but we're going to learn from mistakes and we're going to get better. And, you know, my goal is to see you guys progress in your career. And it's just so great to see where you guys have. And I'm so blessed for your friendship. I know we joke around a lot on this clawcast and we're going to continue to do that. But it was really great. It was, you know, it's been a blessing. I mean, I just enjoy working with you guys in any capacity. When you called me up and said, I want to do the podcast. And I'm like, well, it's about freaking time. Cause I've been only talking about this for about 3 or 4 years, but the timing was right now. And we're doing it. And it's been just a ton of fun and off we go.
We love you, Dennis. You're a brother to us. And you know, it was just such a, you were there for us when we didn't even know we needed it most. And you were patient through our immaturity. You know, we were young and
just didn't get it.
Didn't get what an honor it was to be a Von Erich, to go to Japan and all this stuff. And it's just, it's, you really, really helped us. And it's, I'm glad that you weren't you weren't involved in the wrestling world, because it was good to have an outside mind.
It was kind of refreshing. Yeah.
And to have an actual genuine fan's perspective after a show, is because, you know, in our matches, we notice every single fault with it. We can see it. But you know, not everybody sees everything. And getting the fan perspective from you, like, no, that was good. You guys did this, you did that. And it helped a lot. But yeah, we definitely formed a brotherhood.
Yeah, those road trips, man, those were some good times.
Yeah, those empty Oklahoma roads in the middle of nowhere, Texas, you know, just laughing, joking, eating Arby's, farting, locking the windows, all the good stuff.
Well, you farted, not me or Russ. I mean, that was you.
No, the sewage treatment plant. Yeah. Anytime someone would rip one, they would just say, are we passing a sewage treatment plant?
It was like the inside joke at the time. Yeah.
Yeah, those were some good times.
It happened a lot.
That was the hardest I ever heard you laugh at.
I hope that maybe in the future we can pick up a few indie shows and do some road trips together, because that was those are
so. Yeah, relax, small fry. We're big time now. All right, we don't do driving by ourselves. Okay, we have private planes get limo drivers. Not yet, but it's coming.
Yeah. Limo riding, high flights, kids stealing, wheeling, dealing.
We wanted to be limo riding, jet flying, all that stuff. We would have gone to that.
Yeah, yeah.
The dark place.
Oh wait, I'm sorry. I'm banned from doing
the dark side.
I'm banned from doing wrestling impersonations.
Oh yeah. Oh hey, it's a temporary ban. I have a fan question, real quick.
Yeah, fan question.
Pull it up real quick.
Okay, we have a fan.
Ross, talk about your life. I'm looking for this.
So, Dennis, what's new with you?
What's new with me? Well, that's a good question. I actually joined a band, and I'm going to start singing in a band this summer. We're going to do a few gigs out at a place at,
for real?
Yeah, Pier 121 out Lake Louisville. And anybody in the Dallas-Fort Worth area that's listening, we'll post up when we're going to have a gig. But we're going to do about 10 songs. I'm going to sing with this band, and then afterwards, I'm going to do some DJing where we keep.
You give me a sample right now. Give me a sample. That's a great
hands example. Touching right. Hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you, sweet Caroline. Bah, 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 bah.
Okay.
Good times never seem so good. So good.
So good.
So good. Yeah, we're doing that song.
Okay. I was gonna roast you, but that was an excellent choice.
Yeah. You have tears in my eyes.
I commend you. That was great.
That's enough, Dennis.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't want to. Yeah. Okay, so here I found the fan question. It's from a handsome cat named Marshall Van Erich. So the question was, I posted on the Iron Claw Cast, do you have any last minute questions before the Iron Claw Cast show starts? And from Marshall Van Erich, yes. Why does Marshall Van Erich cross his eyes every time he does a lariat? And you're a handsome cat, but you're a little bit foolish. It's Eric. Okay, buddy. You seem like a nice guy for the most part, but why I cross my eyes when I yell, I don't know. I blame it on the movie Waterboy, but I don't know. I did it as a joke for so long that it became serious. When I joke and Ross, I'm going to get you. I'd say, rah! And I go cross-eyed. Please don't use that as a thumbnail just now.
Oh, yeah.
No, but
now everybody's going to.
Yeah. But so I would do that as a joke. And then I started doing it in football. And one time there was a sick picture of me tackling somebody and it was in the newspaper. And sure enough, I was doing this all cross-eyed. And I was like, shoot, it really is a problem. And so
when he plays with the kids and stuff and he's like a big monster, he's always doing the.
I was trying to be as ugly as possible. And then I was like, okay, I can't.
And it became a habit, like a muscle memory thing almost. Yeah. And so it's been like an inside joke and it's just been so funny every time.
We found some crazy pictures that we'd zoom in and I'm sure enough.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Like cross-eyed.
It's gold though, but if, yeah.
I call it the cross-eyed clothesline.
Yeah.
Those were some good times. And you know what? The you posted a picture. Were you cross-eyed in the picture you posted of the hunting when you were a little kid with your dad and
no.
Same place your grandfather was with your dad and your uncles?
I just have strong eyebrow muscles.
Yeah. There was not a lariat being performed at that moment. And so
that was a cool picture though, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, it was at the exact same spot.
The exact same spot, same land. just, it was so cool as kids that we, like, again, maturity, but did not really appreciate it yet. But as kids, we grew up on the same field, sweat and worked on the exact same field.
Our uncles climbed the same trees,
The magic tree, it's called the magic tree on our property. And my dad and his brothers would hang on the limbs when they were really young and swing all over them. And that's the tree that we grew up on. We built tree houses in it, a kid tree houses, laid a whole bunch of sticks flat and fell out thousands of times.
Yeah.
That is so cool. And it's kind of sad that the old Von Erich Ranch is now a housing development in Lake Dallas.
Yeah, it's actually, it's called
Ranch. Yeah, right?
It's called Atkinson Ranch, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a little sad to see that, but we had some good memories there.
Big time.
We'll always have that.
But
yeah, it's cool.
Do we have any more fan questions?
We should have fans call in live sometime. We should do a live.
That'd be really cool. We were talking about that having fans on the show every now and then, and we'll do it randomly. I think that'd be kind of cool.
Yeah, no, it would be I think it'd be a benefit. And we should definitely look at doing. This has been kind of a fun format tonight because it's freestyle. We really didn't have a structure and we just wanted to just kind of be real. And in the vein of just being real, I believe sometimes vulnerability is part of being real. And I shared it with you guys a little earlier today, but I wanted to share with you guys something I experienced today. If we could kind of get serious for a minute, can we do that? This last year has been tough on everybody. With COVID hitting, a lot of people lost their jobs, and I was one of them, working in the travel industry, working in a capacity where your company's business went down by 90% was tough. And so they made a lot of cuts, not being able to see your kiddo, because of the COVID risks, a lot of difficulties, and it's just been a challenging year. And, sometimes as much as we're up, we can also be down a little bit. And I was talking to my sister, my older sister, believe it or not, I've got an older sister, like you guys have an older sister. And there's a lot of similarities between my older sister and Kristen. She's kind of that glue of the family, so to speak. But she invited me to church today and I went. She's been asking me to go to church for their new church for a while. And I've always had stuff going on, but I said, today I'm going. And sure enough, I get up and the first thing I do is I hit traffic because I have Interstate 635 in Dallas shut down, all the way shut down with Texas DOT trucks. They're doing some kind of
How dead traffic too. Ugh, you hate
horrible. I hated traffic. So I finally get there. I get there about 5 minutes into it and connect with them. And they're doing the greetings and the announcements and everything. And then they introduce some guy that walks out. I'm like, who is this guy? And he starts talking. I'm like, who is this guy? Well, he is a pastor of a church in California, and he has written books. And the book he wrote that he talked about today, his name is Sean Nepstad. And the name of his book is called Don't Quit in the Dip. And I want to bring this up because I've gone through a tough time recently, just the whole unemployed thing, all the things around there. During the pandemic, I'm single. And so not having anybody in your life when you're going through a pandemic or health issues or whatever, it can kind of get on you. And as much as we were positive, sometimes we get down. And I felt like he was talking to me this morning. And it was kind of interesting that after that, I talked to a few other people. They're like, oh, no, he was talking to me. But the whole point is that God's got a plan. And if we trust God, put God in our life, he'll take us through it. Not saying that we're not going to go through tough times, but if we rely on him, he'll get us through the tough times. And he told a really good analogy this morning that I wanted to share. And it was when you get up in the morning and you turn on the water, you turn on the hot water, it's cold for a while. And you don't just stop and turn off the water and go, I'm not taking a shower today because the water's cold and it's never going to get warm. You know that warm water's coming. So why don't we give God a chance to flow that warm water through the pipes? It's coming. If we're going through a tough time, frustration, unemployment, getting another job, or having somebody come in your life that you want fulfillment. you know, understanding that it's God's plan. And I'm not the most spiritual guy. I do have a relationship with God, but I just thought that we're doing this podcast tonight. It is a great book. And anybody that is going through any type of a challenge where you're down, get this book. For me, if you hand me a book, I may not read the book, but if I can get it on audiobook, when I'm driving, I can listen to it. You darn well right, I'll listen to it. Even take a break from listening to the Iron Clawcast, listen to this book. But it's called Don't Quit in the Dip by Sean Nepstad. And it's a scripture-based book, but it is very, very effective. And there, he tells a lot of different anecdotes, stories on people going through tough time, but persevering, trusting on God that pulls through, and he always will. So,
Man, that's so true. And yet we, like Ross just said, you know, we can be so quick to jump ship, and you know, you never know what's initially bad. If something bad happens in your life that you feel is bad, like someone close to you passes, or some just things that we can't explain, like why would this happen? You really never know if it can ultimately be for good, because you know, God can turn anything to bring him glory for good. What the enemy meant for bad, he can turn to good. And you know, I hurt my back. Doctors told me that I was having to get a rod in my back. My disc were ruptured and all this stuff. And while he was telling me this, I was holding my son. And my son, they also told me that that me and my wife might not be able to have a kid. They told us this years ago. And so, that was something I actually like genuinely prayed for, like begged God for. And you know, and as the doctor was telling me I was gonna have to retire from wrestling, I'm holding my promise, I'm holding my son, and I was like, who am I to not trust God? Has he failed me?
It's only a test.
It's like a simulation. And you know, you keep that spiritual mindset. You're there for somebody else, and it's not always about us. We can be so, you know, just self-motivated and self, yeah. How do I feel? But it's, you know, life that takes the pressure off of life. When you look at it, like, who can I encourage today? Who can I love on today? Right. Who can I build up today? You know, and it took me a long time to get in that. And I'm still not perfect. I can get back into being selfish and all that stuff, but it takes the load off life, knowing that I'm not in control, that I'm not, that God is ordaining my life and showing me where to go. And it's just step by step.
Yeah, your job is just enjoy the ride and be grateful.
That's faith. That's faith, is being joyful. Because if you're joyful, you're fully trusting God. You know, you're walking around with joy in your heart. And it's a peace that surpasses understanding, not a peace that comes from understanding.
It's amazing that when you're like, have you noticed when you're down, and you like for some reason encourage somebody else in some way, how you're immediately like rejuvenated
big time.
Like it really is not what it's almost the opposite of what we think, you know, the world. I need the one, you know, to be the one. And sometimes it is good to have, you know, a good word at the right time.
But, you know, if you're when you're younger, did you ever, you know, get like $100 or $200 and you blow it on yourself, you know, four or five times that happens in your life or whatever, and blow it on yourself, and it's never as satisfying as buying something for somebody that needed it. You know, it's like way more rewarding. And you know, that's how God feels with us. You know, he loves to bless us and stuff, but it's, you know, sometimes we'll do something good in our life and we'll think it's so good we want to hold on to it. And yeah, I don't want anybody to touch it. And you can covet what he gave you, a house, car, whatever it is.
But hold on loosely.
Yeah, hold loosely to the things of this world, because you keep your hands open.
You never know what God might give you.
Yeah, like something else. Give up this thing you love so much, and I'll give you something better. You know, and
it's always better too.
Yeah, it always is better, you know, and that's what we've been doing in wrestling, honestly, and just living in the moment, taking it day by day, you know, worldly wise, we would be like looked at as almost foolish. You know, you should be investing in your future and
God, you got to look out for number one and all this kind of stuff.
Protect yourself. And it's good to look for, like, protect your future and stuff, but that's
truth in that.
Yeah. We've had a job for, you know, 10 years almost. We've been wrestlers for a big portion of our lives now. And
it shouldn't really even be possible living out here.
Yeah. And living in Hawaii, it's almost impossible to get booked. And it's been working. It's just step by step, moment by moment.
If you have a good agent, you're gonna get matches. I'm just saying.
That's what we need. We need a good agent.
Man, good idea. You can really use one of those. Yeah.
But you know what? On a serious note, I'm going to be 53 2 weeks from today. I don't mind revealing my age because I look so young. But you know, I think this morning sitting at my sister's church, I had like this breakthrough that I'm like, okay, there was just the way he spoke and the way he talked about, the dip, you know, when you go through a dip in life, and sometimes that dip may seem like a chasm. I so much want to have, just this special, awesome woman in my life to grow old with. And I've been divorced for 6.5 years and I've dated a few people. I thought I found the pot of gold, but kind of sometimes it turns out to be fool's gold. And I'm not knocking anybody I've dated in the past. It just doesn't work. And, you know, when there's something you really want, you have to step back and say, well, you know what, who am I really putting in charge of my life? Is it my will or the will of somebody else's? So it was really, really, I'm really happy about this being a breakthrough day. And I'm glad to be able to share this with
you and
the clock ass nation out there. So.
Yeah. All right. We're happy for you.
Yeah. God gives his best to those that leave it up to him. Something we've always gone by. So, you know, it doesn't really make sense. Go ahead.
No, I was saying Ross told me one time that there's his permissive will and God's will, and permissive will is
perfect.
Yeah. Where you're forcing stuff happen, kind of making things happen. And is this your will, you know, and his will really is good. So there's this story about this man, and he was with his servant, and a horse wandered on their property. And he said, and the servant came to the man and said, hey, there's a horse on our property. This is bad. And he said, how do you know this is bad? And the next day, his son got on the horse and got bucked off and broke his arm. And the servant came and said, your son broke his arm. This is bad. He said, how do you know it's bad? It could be good. And then the next day, the military was in town, and they were taking recruits. And they said, your son couldn't get recruited because his arm is broken. This is good. And he said, how do you know this is good? And it's just what it's saying is
it goes on and on.
Yeah, it goes for a while. And we just initially don't know what's bad. If something bad happens to life, lose your job, something better. God could have something better in store. And so you're not wasting time. You're going to get your hopes up. You're wasting time being hopeful. That's not wasted time.
Plus, you worry way less. Yeah. That's what we're supposed to do, not worry.
That's where heart disease, you know, the Bible says that,
passion is rottenness to the bones. Like when you get worked up think about something, dread something, you're overthinking, anxiety, you know, that's not good. That's not healthy.
Yeah.
To think that way.
We're full of that. You know, it's constant, but it's good to have a brother to remind each other, but just to walk around with a light heart. Nothing's as big as you make it seem. This life is so temporary. You're not going to be, you know, young forever. You know, it's you know, life goes by, and so that's why we want to enjoy each moment as it comes and embrace it and spend this time with my dad. That's why we're choosing, you know, family over wrestling as of right now. You know, we could be living in the mainland and you know, working for a big corporation, which we probably will do one day, but right now we're enjoying these days with my dad. And he's had a nuts life, and you know, we can make it work over here. We're working over in Hawaii, and we're also wrestling. So it's like God's made it come about. And until that door closes, we'll go in the next one that opens. But you know, it's easier to know that I'm not in control. I didn't make this happen. This is where I am.
Well, if there's anybody that personifies not quitting in a dip, or really in a chasm, is your dad, and how your dad kept going, and you know what a fine example that is, and I know we touched on that a little bit with him. We'll have him on again. We can maybe go a little deeper, but look no further than your dad in terms of all that's happened to him and how he's kept going, how he's made decisions to follow God, choose life, and look at the life he has now.
He's always got a smile on his face. You look at dad, and he really is so joyful. And, you know, he says, you know, it's not worth it to hold a grudge. You know, he said, go forgive that person you're mad at right now. It's not worth it. No, these little petty things we can get mad at, sometimes they feel monumental and big, but.
And it's a testimony. It all works out in the end. It all gets good in the end. You know, my dad is the most joyful he's ever been. He has a huge family.
Double around the family.
Him. And if you would have told him, you know, while in the 80s or whatever, while he's going through it, it's all going to be good. He's like, there's no way. Yeah. It just, you know, you don't see it. You know,
he said one time he was in his car, and it was right after my Uncle Mike passed away, and he was praying, and he said, well, God, now, now I'll never be able to fully enjoy anything again. I'll never be happy ever again. He said there was something broken in him.
Like wounded.
Deeply wounded, where he said he felt like he could never experience happiness ever again. And he said, and, you know, now he'll say that, you know, I felt like I was stuck, and but he held on, you know, he kept going.
It almost gave him a greater capacity to enjoy life and enjoy it and to love.
When he hugs somebody, he like embraces him, and we just laugh about it because it's like, man, he's been through so much, and he's the funniest guy you've ever met. He's so lighthearted. He's always joking. And sometimes it's almost annoying that he's like so happy and joking all the time. We'll be in like a tense situation about to debut at TNA for Father's Day or whatever, and he's like, you know, pinching the back of your arm, spraying you with water, you know, just laughing. No, Dad, this is serious. You don't know. And he's like, I know exactly what you're going through, you know? And so we wish, you know, if we go back, we wish we were just, you know, goofed off with them, enjoyed the moment instead of being all serious and tense, you know? But now we do. So that's a big blessing. Now we enjoy matches so much more than we did before, especially when my dad goes, you know, like there's a certain number of times that this will happen. So let's enjoy it while it lasts.
Totally.
His love and passion is infectious. He just wears it on his sleeve. It's just there. He's the same guy off the, you know, out of the limelight as he is in the limelight.
There's no joke or there's no gimmick with that.
Yeah, what you see is what you get for sure.
I remember one time when I was out in Kauai one time, we were sitting in the living room on the couch and he was talking about wrestling some kind of match. He's like, well, here, stand up. I'm going to show you. Now, Lockheads, okay, I'm going to show you what he did at this and that. And it was just like, okay, I'm sitting here locked up with Kevin Von Erich, and I have no idea what kind of wrestling moves we were supposed to make or anything. But he was like just so demonstrative about showing me whatever happened in this match.
Yeah.
Hilarious.
He always does that. If he has a wrestling move in his mind, he'll go up to my mom or something, a lock, you know. And I do it to Coral, you know, or I'll do it to him.
I think the business does that
too. Yeah.
You're so animated. When you tell stories, it's –
everything's big. You know, my mom said, like, when we all three get excited telling a story, my mom said that, like, yeah, stuff gets broken, and we're like, and then the guy did this, and you know, we're just going crazy with our hands, and real big, and it's cool too. Wrestling brought us to a point where we can really relate with Dad now. You know, we always be like joking and stuff. But hey, I was gonna say to everyone listening, sorry we didn't have a something. What do you call it? Foundation or whatever stuff to talk about, pretty much. But next week we're gonna have a guest on, and possibly my dad. And then keep letting us know what guests you want us to have. Send your requests in. They doesn't have to be wrestling, completely anybody. Wrestling. It can be anybody and stuff. We have a couple good names in mind, but we want to keep you guys entertained. We all love doing this. This has been a huge blessing to all three of us. And I really enjoyed this podcast. Let us know if you guys did, but yeah, we're really trying at this. We want to put ourselves like go all out at it. It's like in wrestling and stuff, but yeah, like give us your feedback. Let us know who you want. And thank you for listening.
And where can we find everybody? Where can everybody find us on social media, Marshall and Ross?
We are on Twitter at the Iron Claw Cast, YouTube, the Iron Claw Cast. Spotify, Apple Podcast, Anchor, Google something. We're on all of them. We're on pretty much all of them. Go check us out. And we actually, coming soon, we might start an Instagram, you know, because the younger generation, they most of them have an Instagram.
Whippersnappers.
Yeah. Whippersnappers. And then we're going to start getting our stories out there. You know, we've had a lot of good guests already. And so keep supporting us. We love you guys. We're nothing without y'all.
We appreciate it. And we'll be back next week with another brand new episode of the Iron Claw Cast. Thank you for tuning in. On behalf of Ross and Von Erich, I'm Dennis Crosby. And as always, stay clawrific.
Stay classy.